In our third conversation, How to Live Because of Love, my partner and husband, Andrea Pagnes, artist and author, talks with Italian artist Franko B about that which constitutes and springs out of love and hope. They look into the poetic qualities of vulnerability as the source of artistic and personal integrity. They speak about the function of art as a language to place dissent and resistance. They question violence and its artistic symbolism, precisely that one concerning their Italian cultural background, and inquire into the quest for freedom and our failures that accompany it. Franko B makes performances, drawings, installations, and sculptures. Born and raised in Italy, since 1979, he lives and works in London. He is a professor of sculpture at l'Accademia Albertina di Belle Arti in Turin, Italy, and a visiting lecturer at the Royal College of Art in London. Franko is an artist who doesn't separate life from practice, with his work situated somewhere between isolation and seduction, kind-heartedness and confrontation, suffering and eroticism, punk and poetry. His concern is to make the unbearable bearable and provoke the viewers to reconsider their understanding of beauty and suffering. He uses his body as a metaphor for social struggle, where the personal becomes political and structures his unique poetics. Projecting the confluence of love and pain, Franko B demonstrates that the characteristics and critical events that compose the essentials of human existence can be reformed, that is, the human condition. Welcome to the momentum of April 25th, 2021.
When someone tells you of their life outspokenly, at open heart, every moment assumes its importance. As we get to know a person better, a natural process acts on our affective sphere. It is a mechanism primarily responsible for building friendship and respect. People we know and value inhabit a part of our brain and soul. We have a copy of them stored in our memory. Not an exact reproduction, but series of images that act on our emotional intelligence. Some books are to our social interest, like fresh water is to the part of our brain when we are thirsty. Franko, with your autobiography, Because of Love, you have managed to get me into your life story straightforwardly. There is a witch very profound, almost primordial, rushing inside from chapter to chapter on a meta level of reading. I think it belongs to the sphere of instinct, fundamental for survival. In your book, you retrace events from your childhood to adulthood, touching on different subjects pertaining the human soul, and thus inviting the reader to reflect on them. One of these subjects is that of vulnerability, which by definition is the inability to withstand the effects of a hostile environment. We can't eliminate vulnerability from our life because it is part of human nature, but perhaps it is by showing it openly that we can learn the gifts of loving fully. And so now, Franko, I would like to start exactly from your autobiography, Because of Love, where you bear your soul to the reader and you recount all that you went through and outlived. Your personal becomes political, while through your art, you make the unbearable bearable to confront the human condition in its most vulnerable and cardinal state. So precisely, I would like to start our conversation asking you about vulnerability. Perhaps the moment in which we feel the most vulnerable, exposed, and at risk, are also those that mark our existence and make it worth living. Accepting our vulnerability means also being willing to stay open, show our wounds, accept our imperfection, and work on them, or make a work of art out of them. So I believe that to genuinely show yourself vulnerable require also great courage and empathy to free self-expression and creativity. So when you say to make them bearable, bearable, to confront the human condition in its most vulnerable incarnate state, can you please unfold a little bit more this statement?
It's a very deep, I may find a question, some question are very deep, but they require very simple answers sometimes, which is boring, because obviously it's not two sentence answer, it's not two words answer. But I think essentially, we have to go beyond the idea that the work is separated to who I am. I think essentially I am who I am. If I'm vulnerable, I'm vulnerable because we all vulnerable, I think. We are all vulnerable to the element. You know, we are vulnerable at every moment, any moment we are. There's a difference, though, not to misunderstand vulnerability with being possible victim to events or to things. We are essentially, we are honest and open, we are vulnerable. We are vulnerable all the time. Everybody is. Now, so to translate that into work for me or for an artist, I don't think there doesn't need much construction. It's simply, it is that situation. The artist or the artist's body, whatever that is, whatever is a canvas, a transport that he, she uses to talk about what does it mean to be alive, it doesn't matter. It shows that. Doesn't need theater for this. Doesn't need scenography. It is what the artist has to do, whatever that is, you know, has to just allow it to be his canvas, you know, to allow to be, to show. And this goes back to this, I think, profound idea and sentiment that not just I have, but I heard other people, that the true artist, is what makes a true artist, is not art, it's not genius, it's not about geniality. The artist, I think, a true artist is one that is a monster, un mostro, yeah? The word mostra, like I said many times, is from the Latin word mostrare, which is somebody that shows, yeah? So the artist is somebody that shows the world, is a witness, and then also a witness willing to be counted for. Like in a way you could say the same witness that can be, let's say, in America, a 16-year-old girl that goes to the shop with a younger cousin and has her telephone and sees police brutality and video it. Yeah? She's not an art. She's the moment that she is aware of what she's doing. She's a witness, not a passive one. Then she can call it back. If she wants to, if you want, you can call her an artist. She might not want to call herself an artist, but she is somebody, she's a witness, willing to be counted, willing to say, this is what I saw, this is what is happening, you know? I think so. That is what would being vulnerable, I think, if it makes sense.
Yeah, it makes sense.
It's not, the thing is, you know, be vulnerable. It's not that it's something that you can construct. This, I go back to this. It's not something ci possiamo inventare di creare, at 3 o'clock in the morning, we are there. How do I show vulnerability? You don't fucking have to think about that. You don't. You don't. You don't. The moment you think it, it's a failure. You're not. You do something else, you know?
So it is like what you say. It's like the sense is, it's just quoting you, no? If we do not share what we got first, which is ourself in the most naked, vulnerable sense, we cannot be artists.
No, totally. Yeah, but what I'm saying, that not only artists do that, everybody do that. Then one chooses the channel, you know? Somebody choose religion, somebody choose money, somebody choose, you know, different thing. I chose, I didn't choose art. Art chose me.
Certo.
You know?
Yeah, right. So from vulnerability, Franco,
recalling your difficult childhood, you write, when you come from nothing, from trash, you have to learn to get by on your own. But art has been very generous to me because it gave me life. So for me, it's important to share this generosity. Generous people give more than is required from them. They are those who decide to go one step beyond what one expects of them without asking anything in return. There is a great sense of care, gentleness, and loving kindness in being generous. A person can be helpful because of its nature, or becomes generous after a work of profound insight. We are all made of the same substance, love and suffering, but no materialistic vision or approach to life can help us to find some meaningful fulfillment if we do not share, as you wrote, what we got first, which is ourself in the most naked, vulnerable state. For me, your art is a quest of liberation pursued by relying on the inextinguishable power of love, radical empathy, and existential creativity as it builds, forces which should permanently inhabit an artistic soul regardless of any hostile private, social, political context. In your poetics, love serves as a need and a duty, and all that unfolds from it in terms of authenticity, justice, tolerance, romance, and ultimately grace. Perhaps love is just the quintessence of generosity, as you say, sharing support, and precisely for this, it escapes any restrictive definition. In many of your performances and work, Franco, videos and visuals, what I detect is sometimes a pervasive sense of remote loss that often transpires. I'm thinking, for example, to your seminal performance, I Miss You, but also to the last works of the Lost Boys, the ceramics that you're currently making. However, the sense of loss, you always sublimate and heal it by expression of greater love. We can speak infinitely about love, but what is love for Franco? What is love for Franco?
Take all your time, Franco.
No, I try to think. Well, it's a lot of things. Love is generosity. Love is kind and kindness from people you don't know. Love is why, I suppose, you get out of bed in the morning, you know. And it's simple, you know. You can put in a very simple, pragmatic things, you know. There's 3 reasons why I'm still alive today, you know? why I get up in the morning. Let's put it that way. Why do I get up in the morning? I get up in the morning because my partner, because of my dog, because of my student, because I feel I have given myself, I committed myself, you know? So till I have these three commitments, you know, I will get out of bed in the morning. It means I would feel love and be loved and want to carry on, be alive, you know? It's immense. I mean, you know, it's not, yeah. I mean, more than that, I don't know how to put it really, because it's simple and also it's complicated, you know. If you, you know, love is not some, it's, when we talk about love, it's not just about a romantic thing. But it's about being in the world, empathy. It's about generosity. It's about willing to not to be afraid to trust someone, you know, or trust yourself, you know? Yeah, and to be brutally honest to yourself as well. That is love, because also love is about also being honest with yourself, you know? And if you can do that, then I can be honest with you.
Is it also, Franco, because then at a certain point of your life, you really assert that although your life before was very complicated, at a certain point you say, you says, art has been very generous to me.
Yes.
And because of this, I gave my life to art. And so it's an act of love. It's not an art of will or intention to become an artist, to be an artist, but it's dedicating my life to that.
Well, it's like a lifeline was thrown to me, you know? Yeah, totally. Art from, yes. Despite my upbringing and my biography, I think life is complicated for everybody. Even for the most happy, successful, you know, materially confident, you know, life is complicated for everybody. I'm lucky in a way, but I don't think it matters how much you have, how many difficulty or problematic you had as a child, what kind of upbringing you have. It's not, I don't think that is simplistic enough to say, oh, poor guy, he suffered. That's why he has empathy. No, I know a lot of people that suffer, miserable fucker, don't have any empathy, you know, for anybody else, you know. It's not necessary that I do believe that first we have to liberate ourselves from our chip on our shoulder, whatever that is. Yeah? Yeah. It doesn't matter where we come from.
Yeah.
There's a little thing, you know, that is like, I suppose I compare it like when you're addicted to heroin or something that sits on your shoulder. You have to get rid of that. It's a metaphor.
Yeah.
You know, you have to totally liberate yourself from that for be able to carry on. Yeah, and be able to say, you know, be able to kind of somehow say, I don't want to have any rancore.
Rancor, yeah, grudge. Yeah,
that kills you, you know, to have rancor towards people or things, the situation that happened to me that made me feel shit, and you know, you can, you move on, you know. I think the key things is to make sure that you are aware when other people go through the same thing and be there for them if you can. Yeah. Yeah. And I think I goes back to this thing, the way things that there's a difference between feel total isolation and being alone, you know? Being alone, you is a situation you are in control of. To be unloved or lonely is not, you know?
We cannot expect that society fill gaps and wounds we have in our hearts. It is my responsibility as a person to heal myself, thus improve my relationship with others. For instance, I should understand that when I notice something lacking outside of me, it might actually be what is lacking precisely in me, my capacity for love, understanding, forgiveness, at last. Mm. Art and life are unceasing work in progress, processes of learning to let go rather than learning to acquire. There is no other way around that. There are no shortcuts. You are in it as long as you are still breathing. Still, we all share the same yearning, the same longing, and the same difficult questioning. What is to be a human being? Yeah. How can we improve our mutual relationship for the better? Life is short, fragile, precisely in that manner because it is so delicate. It teaches us to value our human existence and continually suggest to us the possibility of how to subvert, reimagine, and redefine the social agreement that establish explicit and implicit moral rules, norms, and behavioral policies between individuals in society. Life is an experience that breaks us open, you wrote, so that we can recognize who we are and what we have, what informs our ever-changing social identity, what we likely can pass over, and what we should honor instead, like duly respect the other's dignity and keep intact, at the same time, our own integrity. Franco, how do you tackle integrity as a person, as a human being, as an artist, and also as a queer?
Well, again, it goes back. Well, I really think, well, you know, can I look myself at the mirror and saying to myself, I'm not a fraud, you know? That is from a personal. I have to be able to look at myself to you know, in this, what you call an internal introspective mirror, you know, and say, and be able not to feel and feel that for whatever reason, even if I'm deluded or pass as a fool, I can honestly say that I'm honest with myself.
Yes. Is it a matter of courage also, this one? Because sometimes integrity, the opposite of integrity is that you make compromise to achieve something, no? And
yeah. But in the scheme of things, compromise, which I, from technical point of view, like what is a compromise? I mean, a compromise, would you tolerate certain behavior to get where you wanted to get, or compromises, black and white thing, like, you know, this thing doesn't work, you know, why don't we try this, you know, or this doesn't suit me. That is different, you know. I think essentially, you should never compromise your integrity from a standing point of making sure that you're, that at least you are not irresponsible towards others, really. It's one thing can say I'm compromising myself, but compromising somebody else's life or compromising somebody else, you know, that is another thing. I mean, we can go on about today, 2021, as opposed, you know, yesterday, 50 years ago, 100 years ago. I think the dynamics don't change. What changes is that the technology that deals and manifests its dynamics. You know, essentially, I do believe that as what we are, and we are what we are for thousands of years, essentially, probably, apart from the technology, yeah, we are basic, you know? We are basic. We are motherfuckers.
Yeah.
We are basic motherfuckers that want more or, you know, want what somebody else already has or doesn't want anybody else to have, you know. I mean, we basically express this instinct as childs, you know, as kids. And we might put weight on and we develop, you know, into adult human being. But the instinct, I'm not talking about animal instinct. I'm talking about the instinct of man, you know, to wanting power. Yeah? To realize when I talk man, I don't talk about male, I'm talking about human. When a human realizes that it doesn't have power, the only remedy for that is to have it. Yeah? If it's in a position to think like that, he, she can do that, of course. Yeah? If it's in the position or in that kind of introspective, you know, I don't want to be on my knees the rest of my life. I ain't gonna get up on my fucking knees and get you on your fucking knees. Yeah, that is one remedy. Or the other remedy is, which I think is more mine, I don't want to be on my fucking knees the rest of my life, and I don't want anybody else to be. And I'll try as much as I can, directly and indirectly, try not to do this to others. Try to not to do to others what I don't want done to myself. And of course, also, it doesn't mean because I want it done to myself, I want it to be done to somebody else, you know? So it's also that, you know? It's not about being liberal, you know, so everybody should live their life, you know. Well, yes, but not if you're a motherfucker. You know, you can be liberal with fascism. Yeah. You can't be liberal with, you know, with egoistic, you know, self-centered, you know, piece of shit, you know. You can, you know. Tolerate them, you know. So the integrity, you know, I mean, integrity, I think there's integrity of the person, and then there's, of course, there's integrity of the work, you know. I know people that have great integrity with the work, but not as people, and vice versa, you know. Yeah, it's possible. See, and also be able to really look at yourself in this inside you and say, I am, a, you know, ask yourself if you are a bullshitter or not. You know, I am, you know, if I'm lying to myself or I'm bullshitting to myself, you know, you can say I'm bullshitting and I accept that, but I need to be able, honestly, to answer that to myself, you know, as a, you know, is it all a farce? Is it just I make it up as I go along? You know? Yeah. You have to, and you have to be able to be honest about that. And sometimes you think, eventually, sometimes you do think that in a way, it's most of the time to yourself, you are making it up as you go along, you know?
Franco, the next thing I would like that you can say to us few things about discrimination, for example, okay? Discrimination is not just racial. I mean, it's widespread. No. Racial discrimination and integration are still unsolved problems. We have immigration continually. There are thousands of hundreds of people that are still vagrants in all our countries.
Yeah.
And this brings also to the question of the sense of home, the sense of belonging.
Yeah.
And your life experience, you know, you have been discriminated and you have been many times with no home, and you worked a whole life to mend discrimination problems and probably to find home, which I believe that home is also, the first home is inside ourselves probably.
Yeah.
But also inside of the others. So yeah. If we are able to see this mutually, if I see myself that I found in you a sense of home and vice versa, also the disparities, inequalities, and discriminative thoughts can be erased, if not reduced at least, you know. And what is your position in it? Because, you know, it's...
I don't think it's that black and white in terms that you're talking about discrimination.
In a wide sense, of course, yeah.
Yeah, in a social, political, geographical sense, you know, where, yes, it's true. I try to live my life where, not just because I know where I come from, but thinking that empathy, you know, again, empathy. So if you have empathy, I think you're less likely to have this mistrust, you know, towards others that you don't know just because you have fear of them. But let's go back to this idea of discrimination outside that. I'm talking about how the instinct, the first instinct we have, like when we come to something we don't know, is, I find a lot of time, is discriminative. You know, you do think, oh, I should be careful. Oh, do I know him? Oh, do I know? You know, so the key things, you know, ideally we have to try. There's this thing. One way is we have this sense of self-protection, you know, and paranoia. It's the difficult one because naturally we have an instinct to protect ourselves. So when we are in a situation, the, you know, there's ignorance, and then there is a self-instinct or self-preparation, you know, what you call it. But it's about try to stay open, really, you know. The ignorant thing is like taste, sometimes also taste, you know. Oh, I don't like that, but you never tried it. Oh, I don't like this type of music, but you never really tried it. I don't like this type of food, you know, ignorant, basic ignorant stuff like that. And then I think there is us when we are alone, and where we are alone, when we feel that we are in situation where we don't know what's going on, you know, and you try to make sense of what was happening in the moment, you know, you're dealing with, you can be discriminated, you can, somebody, you can, you know, you can, you automatically sometime in some situation feel negative towards somebody that you don't know or how they approach you, you know. So, I mean, you know, again, I think we have to try in every sense, in every day, we try to be, you know, I think emotional intelligence, you know, to use our own emotional intelligence, I think, to make sure that sometimes it's a balance, you know, because knowledge doesn't really necessary, knowing more information doesn't necessarily, you know. So this is what I'm talking about, emotional intelligence, and not what your head knows, yeah. You know, and not what you learned, you know. It's again, it goes back to allow yourself to be vulnerable, to allow yourself to love.
It is like to say that when you see something that is missing in society or it doesn't go well, might be that the same thing is inside you. So I have to work on myself for this.
Yeah, but also is, I think always you have to, I think we have to be, you know, we have to be ready to be vulnerable, to give love or to love and to fail, you know? Yeah, I mean, it's the only way, you know? Apart everything else, intelligently, emotional intelligence, it tells you it's wrong. Xenophobia is wrong. You know, poverty is wrong. Discrimination because of color is wrong. This, you know, emotional intelligence is not, it's not something you learn at school, you know? It's not, you know what I mean? The fact that we don't learn, I mean, in fact, as race, we don't learn from history. We don't learn from past history, you know? We repeat it, you know? Carry on in every sense. So we have to go back to the self, the humans, you know? What is it like, what, to us, to who we are. Yeah, yeah.
Franco, through your art, you have always been a defender of civil and human rights against the arrogance of power, the consolidated power, and the exercise of coercive authority. Mm. Now we live in a time where political consulting firms, media outlets, internet corporations peddle various conspiracy theories and new forms of censorships by shutting out dissenting voices and countervailing facts and mining data. Propaganda, falsehoods, deceit and lies, and the scale of their malfeasance are sadly astounding.
Yeah.
Deliberate crimes contradicting the principles of deontological ethics. In recent years, politicians and the media have done too much to damage and divide people, instigating resentment and separation, to the point of boldly declaring and with impunity that their job is to control people's thought. All that has led to a dangerous strengthening of right-wing thinking and widespread intolerance for the seemingly different and diverse. Within the present scenario, art remains a vital tool for expressing dissent and resistance, I question. Perhaps to the point of going beyond the resistance itself, where artist intimacy and memory shape new poetics. And in fact, intimacy, entwined to encounters with real people along our life path. Intimacy is emotional harmony made up of confidence, affective, and mental complicity. Memory is a catalyst in this sense. It is like a magnet functioning as a selective device, recalling facts and people. Memory fades, they die and resurface with time. Because to remember is likewise dancing between truth, myth-making, and forgetfulness. It is a challenging task. Mm. It is also art and craft in a certain way, to delve deep into the psyche and dust off distant memories to give them a new light. Artists, poets, writers,
share their stories and insight to make sense of the world.
Yeah.
The transience of precarious human existence, find new meaning to the ephemeral, the tragic, and the joyful. This process can be exhausting and painful, for there will be no reward at all in the end. But strangely and opposed to that, some say that to make art to express your most intimate concerns is somehow self-referential, self-serving, or self-indulgent, while to say about others is somehow voyeuristic, even cringeworthy. Yet, art often springs from lived experience, whether sweet or complicated.
Yeah.
And that's why artists are so essential, for they are the chronicles of the time. Franco, does art continue for you to be, or the art making more than the art itself, also a form to express dissent, dissent and resistance?
Yes, it's the only, I mean, it's my voice. It's the only instrument I have, you know? Yeah, it's the only instrument I have that allows me and gives me a platform to express myself. Yeah, in the way I express myself, yeah.
And how you combine dissent, resistance with memory and intimacy. This is, you know, you are... It's not that you make these ingredients all together, you shake them and comes out the work.
No.
I mean, it's a very complex process of how you interrelate these topics together.
Yes, but easy. But I think it happens disingenuously as well. I don't think it's something that you can, it's not a mathematic exercise, you know? It's not an exercise where you think, if I put this together and this together, you know. It's about, again, trusting yourself and be available, really. Yeah, yeah, available for anything.
Because, you know, sometimes also for us, you know, we can receive critics if we work or we make work starting from our memories, from our life stories, from our own intimacies, you know, because...
Yeah, but everybody gets shit.
You know, they can say that you are too self-referential or too self-serving, all these things, no?
Yeah,
I believe that there is something even deeper in that, because as we said at the beginning, it's a matter of vulnerability and openness to unveil yourself, to show your wounds first. And then probably, I think you said this in another interview, it is also a way to access the poetic of life, because I cannot talk about your life if first I've not dissect mine and understand what it is.
Yeah, dissecting is an interesting word, you know, trying to kind of make sense of yours more, of mine, for sure. But essentially, of course, because we are vulnerable, because we are emotionally emotive, you know, and we have a heart, and also we have a head, of course, that sometimes we get criticism, you know, and we get this kind of, you have to somehow, you know, I remember I would get upset at school, you know, but then you have to say, fuck you. You know, it's not very deep.
I am so much with this, you know, all the time.
You know, it's really? Not much. It's not very deep. Say fuck you, whatever. Yeah, leave me alone. It's fine, you know.
Franco, I mean, I believe that.
Sometimes I think when people, the way I kind of disarm my, you know, I turn around and say thinking, oh God, I thought I had problem, you know? Yeah, you know? Yeah.
Yes, yes.
In my opinion, to change radically and help each other properly, we need to step back entirely from the idea of ownership, which is one of the top roots with which we are destroying our planet and ourselves. In the end, we possess nothing, so we need to change perspective. Systems continue to want us to believe that everything is set out for us there, all that kind of materialistic bullshit that they produce, so they can control us and drag us down to a level of social, spiritual, and intellectual inoffensive mediocrity. They invent spurious, convoluted logic to try to absorb and change, especially those who are not aligned, whose behavior is outside of the mainstream. They force people to compete with each other all the time, not just about the working life, but worse, human rights, which are fundamental to our human civilization and its evolution. In this way, they reinforce the whole idea of ownership, which is not a reality, but an elusive belief. But as we are witnessing today, all societal models are crumbling, if not quite clearly collapsing. Life continues to be shocking. But many young people fortunately understand that we cannot carry on in the same box that we have currently put ourselves in it. Paradoxically, the actual global emergencies and the persistence of the crisis of reason create space for the imagination. Therefore, if we can imagine, we can reach out to each other. As Becky Hapanashirwan wrote, you have been able to demonstrate that humanity, as a condition, can be reformed, projecting the confluence of love and pain into your art. Of course, one cannot foresee what might be the future. However, still one can imagine it, have dreams about it, hope and vision, where all the people accept aspects of one another as a beautiful utopia possible to happen.
Yeah, it's this sentence of yours that I like very much. We need dreams and utopias as an example of hope and help us get out of bed every day, as you said before.
Yes.
It is fine if dreams and utopia can do this. Then, of course, sometimes the dreams realized don't necessarily solve anything. Regarding the system and power, fuck them. What I want to ask you, is coming back a little bit to discrimination also. I think that the action that government and politicians take can be useful, but we will not be able to erase discrimination if we don't meet one another. So, yeah. I mean, the revolution starts from our room, from...
But it's us, it's society. We have to take each individual, single us has to take responsibility towards that change, to make that change. And, to vote somebody to carry your voice, which they don't, this so-called democracy process, to elect somebody that speaks for you, for the majority. Yet, apart from this, of course, doesn't happen. It's also majority. It's terrible. It can only speak for the majority, I think democracy is a fuck up. The idea of democracy is a fuck up ideal, because it's discriminatory, It's discriminatory for the minority, or for who is not, for the you have 10 people, they vote, 6 vote for one thing, 4 vote for the other thing, wins who vote, that's democracy example. But, it's just self-serving too. And I think individually, I think the only, it goes back to what I said earlier about power, which is which is something actually I read. Susan Sontag, wrote a small essay called Under the Sign of Saturn, and she talks about she says it was said that the only solution to power is to have it. If you don't have it, to have it, then of course the problem, us being human, it's not what she said now, it's just that, and I say, as we being human, is that we abuse it. We tend to abuse it. we tend to go over it. It's not just enough to say, I'm my own person, but that implies also, unfortunately, sometimes in somehow directly or indirectly pissing on somebody else. You know, we have to learn that maybe this is utopia, that we can't be who we are without pissing on somebody else. You know? Yeah. Yeah. And really thinking about that democracy is not, you know, the 55% voted for this, the 51% voted, you know, is with this, and the 49% is not. No, that to me is not is not simple as that, totally. You know, and actually democracy as a democracia as intended in our society and the patriarchal system is a total fallacy. It's a total fallacy. Yes. Yeah. And we see it. We see it in a society. We see it in the way women are treated, you know, in business, everywhere, the way, you know, still, you know, and not, I'm not talking about, you know, so-called third world country, but, you know, in mainstream, you know, Western, so-called Western civilization, you know, it's not about meeting in a square and we all say, you know, 5 trillion people saying we are free, we want this. No, it's in your lead, everybody in, it has to be almost that everybody thinks, you know, that there's another way. You know, that apart from this kind of sadomasochistic nature of society that we born into, you know, and that we are slaved into, you know, that we can be free. We can be free, but be free. It doesn't just mean free who you are, but be free means that everybody else also is free. It's not just about you. It's not just about you, you know. I don't think we can be free when everybody is, you know, everybody, every single human being, you know, and not only human being, but also being.
In 2016 in Venice, we were talking about freedom and failure, two concepts that fuel imagination and thus art and creativity. Standard definition of the noun freedom, such as the power or right of a person to do, act, speak, say, or think as they want without anyone stopping them, are not entirely exhaustive. Freedom is undoubtedly an inalienable right of the person.
Yes.
But is also intuitive, considerate agreement between individuals.
Exactly.
Precisely based upon mutual respect and responsibility. In short, once freedom implies respecting, protecting, defending the other's freedom also. And also the ordinary definition of failure, such as lack of success in doing or achieving something, is somehow obsolete, because sometimes the unexpected and beautiful may arise precisely from failure.
Yes.
The fact is that our society stigmatizes failure versus success, even though the idea of success has surpassed. Looking at how we are caging our lives, for example, by making them dependent on the keyboard of a computer and reducing them to an amount of digital data, probably the real problem is wanting to be free or not wanting to be.
Yeah.
So in Venice, we were talking about freedom as a choice, and that possibly if we could overcome our failures, we could be free, but we often fail. So yes. To fail is essential to life. But you told me, however, the real failure of today is to accept mediocrity.
But mediocrity is also to accept the status quo.
Yeah, okay.
That's what mediocrity is to accept the status quo, to really failing, not fantastically, but miserably. There's a difference. There's a difference. And I will say, if you're going to fail, do it with style. Don't do it miserably.
But we continue to dissent to the status quo because this is not what stitched to us, okay? It's not what suits us. Yeah.
Yes. But I think it's going back. I tell you, it's amazing. Today, somebody was asking me something. There was a young guy, 28. I know him since he's 21. And we were talking about, he said, you're a very optimistic person. And I think, well, you have to be. You know, I'm optimistic for, I mean, it's one of the things about teaching is that you cannot share in something you know and don't know if you are not, you have to have optimism for them. You know, otherwise you are dishonest. You're dishonest, you know? You're totally dishonest with them and with yourself. You have to hope for them, you know, and allow them to find out what the hope turns into, you know?
And yet we live in a world where violence continues to undermine the hopes of many people. Just like love, violence acts heavily on embodied cognition through the experiences we live, the stories, the memories that tell of resistance, conflict, rebellion, divergence, insurgence, and reconciliation. Violence ruthlessly questions us about what our true nature is. The discourse about violence, state violence, and the representations of violence, which is omnipresent in everyone's life, condition our life continually. Yeah. There is this theatrical spectacularization of violence across the media today, which is insane.
That
violence and the horrors it brings, unfortunately, exist at every latitude. But state and media power are selling us violence as daily food, not exactly what a society of rational and empathic human beings should aspire to achieve. So as artists, we should continue to dissent and reverse this tendency, today more than ever, for the sake of hope, I believe.
Well, I think there's two sides. So first, I think it's true what you say, this violence, the theatrical violence, but what is that we are fed by the media? And this is a way, this anesthetizes us actually. I think there's a deeper violence, which not the physical violence that you see, but the violence of censoring, the violence of fear, you know, is much more subtle, not purely the violence. Yes, of course, it's horrible to see a policeman, you know, killing someone with the knees on their neck while he's saying, I can't.
Or the young girl out 2 days ago.
This, unfortunately, is sad, but it's theater, and it's given, it, you know, what it does, it shows us, but it anesthetizes us. And many times this goes on, and many times this type of violence is probably already repeated somewhere in the world. You know, we are now, you know, I think the news and the media are only what you call a technique by the system, by the state, by the power, you know, by the system, you know, capitalism system, patriarchal system, to kind of keep us under control, to anesthetize us, you know. But there's worse violence. I think there's worse violence, you know, and it's the violence of access to poverty, to come out of poverty. People, you know, the vicious circle that the dynamic of power keeps up to have servants to it, you know? Yeah? This is the worst thing, I think. The fact that we see every day and every other day, we see every so often we get shocked. We see things that we never seen before on TV, in the news and stuff like that, only helps to anesthetize us and to accept that goes on. Mm. Yeah? Yes. I think class, social, accountability, accessibility, you know, it's the worst, you know, discrimination, you know, denying access to somebody else because they're from another caste or they speak another dialect from you, you know, that is the worst violence, you know, segregation, mm-hmm. you know, any type of segregation, and different society do it with language, you know, our language and the way you speak automatically tells you what caste you belong to, type. And you see it, you know, in country where, for example, in Japan with Korean, you know, and how the symbol changes, but, you know, how you cannot, you know, integrate, even generation later, you're not allowed, if you're from another country, you know, you're not allowed to integrate. And it happens in Italy. In Italy, they're trying, you know, it's happening in Italy with people from sub different continent, you know, the children, they have to apply for an Italian passport, you know, that is a very simple example.
You have just said a key word to me, language. In our performance art workshop, at times we bring Wittgenstein as an example of how he depicted a model of the human mind such that the limits of my language mean the limits of my world. Things, as you recently said in the Sky TV program, impossible to articulate, but that through art they are possible because art is not so much about articulating, but to open up yourself and not to be ashamed of that. We then compare it to the way you use the spoken text, the language in your performance, Milk and Blood. A spoken text yes. that is like a poetic mantra for the whole duration of the performance. Everything you list is insignificant, you say, before ending the performance yes. by saying twice, I have language on my side. I think that this one of yours is an essential statement, and that it can be related to what you have said just before about language.
You use language as a tool for freedom. You know, it's not just about talking about the thing I care, but it's how it allows me, how it gives me access to it, really. Yeah. Yeah, so I have language on my side. It's the language, which at the end is also art.
Of course.
You know? Yeah, yeah, that is on my side, you know? Yeah, yeah.
So it's important also to treat art as a language.
It's totally, yeah, but of course, art, whatever, is a test, it's an essay, it's a film or visual thing, but I think for me, philosophy, poetry, of course, but thoughts, you know, thoughts, you know, yeah, totally.
Franco, can I ask you a question that you probably, they ask you, I don't know, thousands and thousands of times, okay, about the blood in performance. Mm.
To use blood in performance is a way of seeking metaphoric or symbolic significance to tell about life otherwise. Also, it is a way to invite the audience to look within themselves through it. Mm.
We consist of bones, flesh, and blood. Blood is essential, as it is the juice of life. In past centuries, blood was a daily reality. Yeah. People knew its viscosity, its aroma. I think also of blood in performance as a way to discover the human and the ancient human being within ourselves, the relationship between rites and myths of the past and today's impulses. Mistakenly, often people confuse the use of blood in performance as a cult. To me, instead, it has to do with cultural anthropology. It is about metaphorizing the red thread between pure and impure, the inexhaustible drama between the sacred and the profane, between the history of the divine and the human history, atonement and redemption. To my thought, however, the use of blood in performance reveals the need for today's human being to find a measure of time and the rhythm of living and work that beats in unison with blood flow, essentially with the metabolism of being human. We are living archives of suffering, love, pain, joy, fears, dreams, all filed, all perfectly coded. Our body often knows more than we do. And when the body speaks its mind, it's essential to listen to it. I think here of your performances, and this is perhaps what I drew the most inspiration from, the performer's body bleeding, a living sculpture that tells a story much deeper than the life story of Franco B himself.
No, totally, because it's not when I perform or when I made work, it's not about Franco B. It's not about Franco B. I'm a human being in front of you, showing you what is like, what showing you life, really. Yeah. I mean, I think essentially the body, you know, the body. I mean, I grew up in Italy in the 60s and 70s. I came here in 79. And I was brought up in the 60s. So in the 60s, you know, I was born in 60s. So 65, 67, I was 7, 69, I was 9, 70, I was 10. When I start to have, not conscience, but certainly I remember things now from that era. I think essentially I say that although I'm a no believer, if I was not born in the moment, in the era, post-war, Second World War era in Italy, with the church, mm-hmm. and the American, you know, being control of the situation and stuff like that, I think I wouldn't be making the, I would not make the work I made, you know, I would have never bled probably. I think it's very different. For me, it's growing up with images of saints, the head chopped off or the eyes on a plate, the teeth chopped off, blood, the wound, San Sebastian's, etc.
It's part of a cultural background in a way. Yeah.
Yes. So that is why. Yeah. And also then, and then the personal stories, the institution, yes. And also encounters with people that tell you certain things, you know. And this idea that obviously I grew up in a culture where I was told that I didn't own my body, you know, I didn't own my body, that the church, the state owned your body, you know? So that is what, in a way, when eventually, thanks then to other connection to punk and to self-education and meeting people that inspired me and took me to places I would have not gone otherwise, you know, both geographically and introspective, then I think I would not make, you know, I would not make the work I make. You know, what made me interesting enough? What makes you? It's either breaks you or makes you. You know, in a way, you know, you could say that what doesn't break is true. There's an old saying, no? Quello che non, what doesn't break you makes you. But actually, I think that you can choose not to be broken, you know? And I chose not to be broken out of foolishness, I think, you know? Because you have to be a fool to believe that you're not going to be broken.
Yes.
You know? Yeah, of course. You know, but essentially, it's not, you know, the work of what I do, it doesn't come out of my own asshole, you know. Yeah, he's the fact I would say, you know, once a Roman Catholic, always a Roman Catholic, you know, in a way, without Roman Catholicesimo in the moment of trouble, Italy, see both domestic in my family, but also what happened outside. When I start at 12, 13, realize the world outside the four walls of the institution that was supposedly protects me, you know, but from what I wanted, probably. But yes, that is what makes you, you know? We are not a product of ourselves. We are not. We are not a product, you know, of ourselves, you know? You, the idea that you make yourself, no, you're trying to evolve and to cross lines and to push and to come investigate and trying to be free, you know, and be happy, you know, and people have a different strategies, you know, sometimes, you know, to do that. Some people have a different values of what might make them happy, and maybe makes them happy, or, you know, making money or having properties or, you know, feel financially secure, you know. And to be honest, yes, I would like to feel a bit more financially secure, but it's not the most important thing. I rather feel I am honest to myself than feel financially more secure, you know, bullshit. Because, yeah, totally. And I really don't think that, I think everybody suffers, you know. Everybody's a survivor, yeah? Everybody. Doesn't matter where you come from, you know? Even the motherfuckers of the royal families are, you know, or somebody that we really hated. That's what they are. They are, you know, I'm not saying I'm being nice. I'm not Gandhi, you know? I'm not Jesus. I'm not cheap Jesus, you know. But lotto survivors are motherfuckers, you know. Lotto motherfuckers are survivors of themselves, you know, of a system or a social constructed environment they were born to.
I have the last question, but this is a question for the Professor Franko B, okay? Because you are an academic professor, no? So
in Italy, it's different.
Yeah, exactly. But
COVID-19 has disrupted habits also in universities and academies. Students are appealing to restore the right to study in person attendance, also because they need social confrontation and build a sense of collectivity and community, which online classrooms can offer only virtually.
Yes.
So I would like to speak to Franco, the academic professor, which you are, at the Academia Albertina in Turin, Italy. You told me that you also noted the kind of intimacy that grew between the students, but I think
that it might have been because of you. I'm not sure if this can be said generally. We are now heading, supposedly, to a post-pandemic effect in the habits of academies and university that have already radically changed through the remote teaching. In addition to that, though, freely accessible education still lacks in many countries. Academic institutions continue to represent money guillotines for many students. What do you foresee in this sense? What could be a change for the better in favor of the students?
I say, okay, I can only speak for art, I mean, my relationship with my students. Yeah. I always say to them that if you come to, if you're going to Academia di Belle Arti, you know, if you're going to an art school, because for, what you call it, for a job, think you're going to get a job, I think you probably got the wrong idea. You know, I think that art is a vocation. It's not a profession. You know, it's not a career.
It's a vocation. Yes.
Yeah, it's a vocation. It's like religion. It's like going to a convent. You know. Yeah, I think so. You know. And you are immersed with people that not necessarily like you, but can exchange and be free to exchange with you. That is the utopia model, yeah? I don't think it's like that. Academy these days, especially, I think it's about first the survival of themselves, you know? Yeah, and students are... second-rate clients, you know? A restaurant treats you better than the academy treats a student. Yeah, I think, in Italy especially. And here, I mean, less about money. I mean, in Italy, the academy is still not that expensive compared to England, yeah? England, you pay 12,000. By the time you come out of education, you own 60,000, yeah? To somebody, yeah? In Italy, a lot of my students are poor enough that they don't pay very much or they get a bursary. So this I can only speak in, for my experience with the situation I know.
So what could be the solution for you? You know, because I think that the world need artists, you know. And especially young generation of artists.
The solution is, I think, independent art school. Individual coming together and try to provide a service, an education or pedagogic on art that is affordable to everybody. Yeah, like mentoring, you know. Yeah, I think, do you need to go to art school? Yes and no, you know. I think I know a lot of artists that didn't go to art school, you know. So, I mean, you know, a lot of my friends didn't go to art school, you know. Ron 80 never went to art school, you know, and a lot of other people. So, I think if you believe you want to be something, want to do something, no matter what, you will do it. Ideally, it will be the utopia thing, again, is to that there should be, you know, people have to do self-help, caro. Dobbiamo aiutarci, aiutare per aiutarci, aiutare per essere aiutati e viceversa. You know, that we have to help others to help themselves, you know? Yeah, and I think alternative, because I can only speak for the system where I teach, I think is very bad, I think, yeah. I think is just there to stay open, to survive as an institution, you know, and to provide jobs for people that work there, administratori, professori, you know. They say that honestly they care for the student, but they don't behave like that. It's very rare. Some people do, but usually, I think there's some people that believe they do good, but in some places they do more good than other. But essentially, like any other clubs, you know, every people more likely that run the club are there to help themselves to run the club. Yeah, yeah, you know?
Franco, the last question. Your perception of the performative space in the digital age, especially in this period of the pandemic. There has been a blossoming of online live streaming performance, video performance, which is good from one side, because it was the only chance that many of us had. However, how do you think that performative practices can intervene in the next future, in these dynamics to which this virtual drift is leading us?
I don't know if it can intervene. I think it's evolution, evoluzione, no? It's a form of evoluzione, you know? So it's like it's the same thing when the Greek invented the wheel, you know, era evoluzione. Quando inventato, when they invented the wheel, it meant they could go to other countries, they could go to longer places, to more far place to conquer, you know? To be honest, it doesn't worry me. I think that let everybody do their thing, and performance art will do the thing. I don't think it's necessary a competition or a negative things, you know. I think that if you're not interested and it doesn't bother you, it doesn't affect you, really. It doesn't affect me. Actually, interesting enough, you know, I started to talk about collaborating with digital before the pandemic, you know? And in a way, with the pandemic, has become also maybe more accessible, more easier to do. But I don't see it as a negative thing. I see it could be a door that opens up, and that you can open the door, look what is outside or inside the door, and decide wherever you are gonna be discriminating or not, going back to your question, and say, oh, this is horrible, you know? It's not gonna affect us. It's not gonna affect you, you know? Yeah. You have your practice, you know? Yeah. Why would somebody be threatened by, you know, and why they should be threatened, you know? I don't think so. I think embrace it, look at it, embrace it, and then use what is useful for you, you know?
So it's an additional tool that we can operate with.
Yes, but also remember that now everything is mediated through digital. Now, look at me and you.
Yeah, but that's why I miss you, you know, because we are together. We are together.
It's the only things we can do. And this is the thing, as long we do what we think is right and it doesn't oppresses anybody, then, you know, the world, we, I mean, at least, you know, it'd be better than what it can be. Yeah, than what it is. Okay, Bamori, ciao.